So we're going to do this taste test. Let's go ahead. We'll take. Let's go ahead and take the first. This whole side right here. Why don't you come up? You can grab a donut. What it looks like. And grab one of these. So I'm not sure if we brought down extra cups, but let's go ahead. What we're going to do is, so let me warn you. First year I did this here at BYU, I did caffeine free, and I was promptly scolded by the students saying, "How could we tell the difference if you're using caffeine free? You gotta use the real stuff." So if you don't feel like you want to try it, this is not caffeine free. So you're welcome to. You don't have to do it, but this is the hard stuff. Just so you know. Okay. All right. So go ahead.
This is like the time.
Take one. And then I'm gonna ask a couple of you who's willing to help pour. This person has Z as Coke, liking Z the best? We open Z for us. Let's just.
Generic.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Shasta.
Virgin.
Big K. You guys like Big K the best. That means you can save a lot of money. Because how much does Big K cost relative to Coke and Pepsi?
One for three.
It's usually about half the price. So you could save some good money by moving to the generic. All right, so now you know X was Pepsi, Y was Coke, and Z was the generic. Okay, how many? Raise your hand if you got them all right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You are a very typical class. Usually less than 20% get all three right. So what does that mean?
We drink less Coke.
It means you drink less Coke. It means you are not the typical Coke drinkers. That's one option, but some people think they know, right? you thought you knew, right?
I thought I knew.
I'll take a dollar.
This is actually important. An important issue, because here we have three colas. What are the margins for Coke and Pepsi?
They were pretty high. I can't remember the exact number. It was like 80. Was it like 80% or something? Oh.
So they have like 80% margins, and yet they're selling a product that, based upon our experience right here, some of the most discriminating customers in the United States, you can't really tell the difference. They're making 80% margins on a product that does not seem to be differentiated. How do you explain that?
Me?
Uh-huh.
As opposed to, like, the...
How do you explain how a company can sell a non-differentiated product and make margins that Intel, that companies that make highly sophisticated products, even Apple, would kill for these kinds of margins? How does that happen?
I think, well, A, they just have a really strong brand name, and B, it's so, basically there's only two really big players that gives them a lot of power, and they can really make a huge, they can make big margins because there's really no one else competing with them.
All right, so let's take a look at this. So it's Marshall, right?
Yes.
So I have Marshall, I also have, let's see, Russell, where's Russell? So Russell, you're going to help us get started today, and Harumi and Scott Pope. Very good. All right. So, but Marshall, let's start with you.
Okay.
All right. So you're saying, you know, it has something to do with brand.
Yeah.
Clearly, they've done has something to do with brand. So Coke and Pepsi have just invested in creating these brands, mm-hmm. and they've convinced us. Mm-hmm. We're just too dumb to know better that Coke and Pepsi is better than Big K, even though you really can't tell the difference.
Yeah.
Okay. So if we're trying to explain their high profits, one is, wow, this is the power of marketing, right? It's like, you know, companies can convince us to pay very high sort of prices, very high margins for a product that really isn't differentiated. There is another option that's probably, you won't be able to tell the difference, but they get you to pay this high price, and it's because of brand. I'm trying to understand why they're so profitable. Sort of brand and marketing. And Marshall, how much do Coke and Pepsi spend per year on brand advertising and marketing? Roughly.
Off the top. Sorry, one second. Do you want me to just guess? Because I would have to look at it really quick.
No, let's not guess.
Okay.
You got it? Yeah.
Yeah, it's in 2009, Coca-Cola spent $234 million. Pepsi spent $136 million.
Okay, this is what year?
This is in 2009.
2009.
Yes.
Okay. So we're looking at the annual spend. We've got Coke 234 million, and Pepsi at 136. 136 million. All right, so these are pretty big numbers. How much, Marshall, did your team, was you were looking to enter this market, mm-hmm. how much did you plan to spend on that sort of advertising, marketing?
We plan to spend, well, I know per case amount, I could calculate really quickly. We plan to spend, they were spending about 21 cents per case on concentrate. We decided to spend about 55.
Okay.
And then they're, with the bottling and the concentrate, they're at about, it was about 50, and we spent basically double that again.
Okay, so when you came in to try and enter this market, you decided we're gonna have to spend two times the amount per case in order to have sort of any sort of splash.
Yeah.
And what did that turn out to be as a percentage of sales?
As a percentage of sales?
Yeah, just roughly.
Well, for the concentrate, it was almost half, and then for the concentrate and bottling, it was about like 23% maybe.
Okay, so basically half of your costs are going to advertising.
Yeah.
And what was your brand strategy here? Anything in particular, how you were gonna come in and make people remember?
Well, we kind of looked at those 4 points you talked about, picking our market. We didn't really have much of a choice of the market other than maybe a type of soda that we could really be differentiated on. As far as like our resources and capabilities, there really isn't much that we could do other than having a different type of soda. And our unique value could only really be that kind of soda.
Okay.
And our various imitation really was just kind of getting a name out there, a brand name for ourselves. So we figured that we'd have to get a new kind of soda, and then we'd have to really market it a lot to make it look good and cool and get people to try it.
So this was sort of, this is, you know, you're forced into a niche strategy mm-hmm. where you're coming in, you're trying to differentiate. Did you guys decide or talk about what kind of, were you gonna have like blueberry twist or what were your flavors? Any sort of idea of
we didn't pick exactly. We were mostly inspired by Dr. Pepper with their niche, but we didn't actually pick a flavor. We just,
By the way, if any of you like Dr. Pepper, you can get Dr. K and it works pretty well. It's very actually, or you can go to Walmart and you could try Dr. Thunder. They're related to Dr. Pepper in some way. I think they're all sort of relatives on the same family tree. But there are other alternatives to Dr. Pepper out there as well, not just the cold side.
Right?
Okay, so you were spending a lot of money to try and come in and overcome this challenge of brand to enter this particular market. Okay, so Russell, how would you explain the high profits of Coke and Pepsi? Is it really just brand? Is there something else that you thought was important?
I think brand or image is kind of the way I view it, that they spend tons of money, you know, Super Bowl ads and whatnot, to create this image of fun, hip, youth, excitement, all that stuff they try to associate with their products. And
so now let me ask you this question.
Sure.
And this is for Marshall as well. Do you drink Coke or Pepsi, or is that why you thought you knew?
I don't drink it a ton. I'm more of a Dr. Pepper kind of guy. So.
Okay. All right. So here's my question. Now that you know that you can't really tell the difference, are you going to switch to the big K cola? You could save some money.
Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to think. So I drink root beer, and I buy I only buy it at like restaurants, so whatever they have there.
Whatever they have, that's what you get?
So, okay. I can't really say.
I actually didn't like the one on the right. I thought it was kind of, I didn't really like the flavor, so I wouldn't switch.
So you wouldn't switch because you thought the middle one was the best. Was that the one?
I thought the first two tasted good, but I thought the third one was
the third
gross.
One didn't. Okay, yes.
Well, I think one of the biggest issues is that nobody wants to walk around drinking Big K, because after, you know, years and years, more than 100 years of advertising, putting an image on that label. It's you're branding yourself by what you drink.
All right, so somehow Derek does not want to invite his friends over for a, you know, a Friday night barbecue, and they pull out the the K-Cola, and his friends are going, oh, Derek, I guess things aren't going so well. For your daughter's birthday party is fantastic.
Right.
They don't, as long as they don't know as you're pouring it back in the kitchen, it's okay. So, but this is actually, don't you think this is a real issue?
Yes.
I mean, if you're having people over, especially if you're buying cans, you can get cans, it's like, do I really want to pull out, you know, the big K Cola with my friends? And the answer is, most of us don't. It's really interesting how it can actually matter that we could have somehow our identity caught up at all with a soft drink that we're providing.
So there, this is the point that there's tremendous brand loyalty in this market. I married into a family that's like a big Diet Coke drinker. And going out to restaurants, if they only have Diet Pepsi and I settle for Diet Pepsi, I'll get shunned.
You'll get harassed.
The room is that, yeah. There's tremendous loyalty to these companies. Best serious advertising to develop and maintain.
Okay, let me ask this question. Why don't we see this then in more businesses? And why just spend a lot of money and convince people that this is the greatest thing out there? Why can't all these other companies do what Coke and Pepsi do? That's dispenser.
Sure.
Just do what Coke did. Just go spend tons of money and have great advertising campaigns and convince people that there's no substitute, even if there are decent substitutes. I mean, we've seen there are decent substitutes, right? So why not just spend more money and convince people to do that? Yeah. Why don't more companies do that?
I think it's the competitive environment of the CSD industry. So there are barriers to entry. If you analyze first right courses, there are barriers that make it difficult in Coke and Cola products and the CSD product, but maybe those horses.
What are those barriers to?
Scale of operations. It's some serious capital expenditures in order to be able to produce at a higher volume.
Okay, so if you think about barriers to entry, you think scale of operations is one. How much does it cost to build a plant?
$3 million.
To enter the concentrate business.
Concentrate.
Yes, loudly. What's the answer? How much does it cost to build a concentrate plant?
We used an estimate of, is it $1 million per?
Yes.
50 to 100 million.
Yeah, it doesn't say 50. It doesn't say 50 to 100 million for a concentrate plant. That's for the entire United States. The concentrate plant will give you concentrate for the entire United States. $50 to $100 million can get you into this business. And how big is this business, do you think, in terms of the size of the total market? Big, right? I think it's somewhere around $60 to $70 billion. Today. So $50 to $100 million, does that sound like that much? That doesn't sound like, I mean, there's no question, I mean, I don't have $50 to $100 million to jump in, but it doesn't seem like that's that huge of an investment. That will give me nationwide ability to produce for the entire United States. $50 to $100 million, I'm there. So the scale of operations that big sounds. Sounds to me like it costs me more to become a bottler.
Sure. pulling up my quarter five courses here. I don't know. So I think the inputs into the concentrate are all commoditized.
Okay.
So that as far as like your actual product differentiation, I think it does come down to brand as we're...
Okay, so you're saying sort of the inputs to your operation, the inputs you're saying, these are not differentiated, they're commodities, right? Which makes it even make more sense to be a concentrate maker, to enter this market with a $50 to $100 million investment, because hey, for $50, $100 million, I can get into a business where my inputs are commodities, but my output could be differentiated, right? So now we're coming back to this issue of brand. There's, you know, brand is like the big barrier entry. That's what you're saying. All right, Harumi, what do you think? Do you think that brand is sort of the barrier to entry? Do you think there are other barriers to entry into this particular, into the concentrate business? What do you think? What do you think drives these high margins, these 70, 80% margins for concentrate?
Well,
I still
work with operations too, but I think mostly shelf space. Because if you go to Walmart and some big stores and you tell them, yeah, I want to put my soda there, they're not going to do that because they want that space for Pepsi and Coke and those big players. So you're going to have a hard time getting your product into the big distributors. And the other thing that I'm thinking is the really low cost, because they have really low cost of production, so people don't mind paying $2 for a drink. Whereas in another industry, you charge a lot, people will not go and pay for it because, I mean, $2 if you go to the grocery store and pay that for a drink, that's not much of a percentage of what you spend in people. But if you go and buy an iPad for like $1,000, if Apple decides to charge for that, that would be a significant portion of your income, and they cannot be able to do that.
All right, Harumi, so the first thing you identified is shelf space. Getting your product on, you know, the shelves is actually not that easy, perhaps. May cost you. The second is they've got this low cost of production and the product's just not that expensive. So people are willing to pay a premium price because, you know, it's still, even though this is 70 cents, you know, for $1.50, it's like, yeah, it's an extra 75 cents, but it's not like it's that much more, right? And your team, did you think about how you would overcome the problem of shelf space or what you'd need to invest to overcome the problem of shelf space?
We actually were not targeting supermarkets. We thought of schools because we were just having this product that was a soda that was healthier than everything else that schools allowed. So we would go through that channel and not worry about
Got it. So you went, let's go different channel to try and get around this barrier to entry. And you decided we're going to use schools as our channel with a product that's targeted, maybe a healthier product or something like that. In theory, did any of the teams in here, anybody think about if you were planning to sell through grocery stores, think about what it would cost you for shelf space? This is something that's easy to overlook, but I want to show you a short video clip. Where we're going to learn about Virgin Cola entering the U.S. market. Now here's a company that actually has brand, right? Brand awareness. So, you know, Virgin has a brand that's, you know, viewed as sort of hip and cool. They target sort of 13-year-olds, beginning sort of teenagers to 29-year-olds. That's sort of their demographic. And so they've got a brand that you think might attract a certain segment of the market to try their product. But they had to deal with this issue of getting shelf space. And this short clip will give us a sense for what the cost is to actually get shelf space in.
Make it like a joke, but plus. market so huge that even a little piece of it would be a fortune. You can look at it this way.
So in fact, every consumer, in man, woman, and child today in the U.S. consumes 2 8-ounce serving sizes of carbonated soft drinks per person per day.
Or you can look at it this way.
If you look at the business, as I said, is a $55 billion a year business in retail. If he could get a one share, that would be $550 million a year, roughly.
1% of the U.S. soft drink market, $500 million.
We've decided just to concentrate on a couple of areas of America and try to get a foothold in those areas and then break out from those areas.
So, how's it going?
What we're hearing is that so far it's been very tough going for Virgin. It's not been easy.
That's true. It certainly has not been easy so far in the States.
No, it has not been easy, not even in Boston. Yeah. Take Tris Abino, who's been carrying Virgin Cola at a shop inside South Station.
Is Virgin Cola selling well?
Not really good.
Or Denise Dawson, who carried Virgin Cola for a while, but found it was taking up space. At Wollaston's Market, which Patrick Ward calls a good account.
How much Virgin is moving through this store, this particular one?
I'd say probably in this store in the last 6 months, maybe 1,000 units total.
And is that a lot, 1,000 bottles?
That's a trick. That's insignificant in numbers of Coca-Cola.
So these are the early days?
These are all very early days. We're crawling right now.
Crawling, because even though the General has millions of dollars to spend, Branson, trying to break into the U.S. market, has undertaken something that is enormously difficult.
Why does America need a new cola? Is exactly the question.
Lou Stern is a marketing professor at the Kellogg School at Northwestern University.
The reality is that there are 20,000 new products introduced into the marketplace every year in these kinds of categories: health and beauty aids, pet foods, food products of all sorts of kinds and varieties. If this is the case, he is one of 20,000. So how is he going to rise above the din? How is he going to get someone to take him on when shelf space is the most precious commodity of all?
So how do you carve out that much sought-after shelf space? It begins with a unique product image behind the scenes with Virgin Cola's ad campaign when we come back.
The cameras rolled, and Virgin Cola the soft drink became Virgin Cola the TV commercial. In the back of everyone's mind was what they were up against, namely this. Coke and Pepsi have been around longer than just about anyone alive. They are part of the American culture, so ubiquitous they almost qualify as architecture. That longevity translates into awesome power in the marketplace. Even Richard Branson admits that.
We're up against a generic name almost with Coke. Really nice sometimes say, have you got a Coke? I mean, Coca-Cola, a Virgin Cola. And that in itself is going to be quite a struggle.
Of those 2 8-ounce servings of carbonated soft drinks drunk by Americans every day,
75% of those are either a Pepsi-Cola and a Coca-Cola, brands that have been around close to 100 years or over 100 years.
So what does Virgin Cola have to do?
To get another cola in the market, you're going to have to really market very heavily in the minds of the consumer that either through better taste, through better packaging, and through prestige, this cola will be demanded.
So what makes Virgin Cola different from Coke or Pepsi? That is the question.
It's not a brand, it's a company with a sort of feeling, and it's sort of a genuine thing there. It's something that's very real, it's not trying to pretend to be something it's not. It's not sort of gold dust, it's not the meaning of life, it's a good cola.
But after meetings with a youngish, hippish Los Angeles ad agency,
we have a kid talking about how babies are made,
a dog that's going to walk up and pee on the box.
Who brought aboard a foolish, nowish documentary filmmaker.
You can shoot down this side, you can shoot across the street. You know.
Virgin decided to make its weakness its message.
It's about taking on the big boys. It's sort of David and Goliath type thing.
It was Richard Branson standing up on a soapbox.
Last year, Coke and Pepsi spent $500 million on advertising and said nothing.
He was taking on the Goliaths, Coke and Pepsi, and then daring the chairman of Coke to stand up and say something. But here was the clincher. Following Branson, any number of people were invited to stand up and say something, anything, over the Virgin logo.
You're joined together in holy union. May you be blessed your whole lives long.
Like it's from the people and it's from the street and it's real and it's raw and it's happening right then, as opposed to Cindy Crawford on a beach with a, you know what I mean?
Well, maybe, but will it work? Again, maybe, says one observer.
There are people looking for something a little hipper, a little something with an edge, and I think Virgin could be that cola.
But that assumes that Virgin Cola actually shows up where the public can find it. In the marketing world, that is one huge assumption. In fact, the one place you will not be seeing Virgin Cola anytime soon is in the Taj Mahal of beverage retailing, the National Chain Supermarket. No, that territory belongs to the big boys with the deep pockets.
It should be no surprise that side by side you have Pepsi and a Coke display.
When Bonnie Tonneson, a food and beverage analyst for Hamrecht & Quist, walks down an aisle, she sees a Monopoly board. Location is everything.
Simply looking at the two displays here, you have Coke going from here, you know, all the way over there, and Pepsi display is much smaller.
Right, which tells us that Coke is it.
In this store, Coke appears to be in.
In fact, look at how many different locations that Coke and Pepsi have in this store.
More Coca-Cola.
In case you want it with your chicken.
Coke and chicken. Chips there and
Coke.
More Coke.
Okay.
And?
More Coke.
Coke is it, partly because Coke can pay. Shelf space in a U.S. supermarket comes with a price. The better the location, say at eye level or near the ends of aisles that shoppers tend to pass by more frequently, the more you have to pay the supermarket to get your product displayed there.
What if I want to manufacture and sell my own drink, soft drink, and I come to the supermarket and say, I want this space? Is it just tough luck?
Well, pretty much tough luck for you, depending how deep your pockets are. There's a whole network that will take you from your manufacturing plant to the store. You pay a fee, a slotting fee, to get your product in the store in the first place.
What kind of money are we talking about to essentially rent space in a supermarket?
People say that the rule of thumb is to get one SKU, one stock keeping unit, on a shelf, it's about $1 million.
$1 million buys you how much shelf space?
Buys you
one line. One line like that, each of those would be $1 million in
Nationally.
It's the way the game is played, but it leaves little space for the little guys.
So the little guys will fight it out.
The little guys will be hurt most.
And the Giants, Coke and Pepsi, sit happily.
And in terms of what they could do, you know, retribution-wise, you know, that's not for me to say. Like, you know, legally, nothing. It's a free war.
So Harumi, how much for one line?
$1 million
for one SKU. This is for one supermarket chain. So if you want national distribution of your product, if you think about the challenges and the costs that would be associated with getting your product available nationally, you don't have to think about, well, how many SKUs, how many lines do we need in order to actually have people notice our product? One's not going to do it, right? It's not like people have to walk in and go, oh, there's that one, you know, somehow they're going to send that one product you're selling. So you're probably going to need, how many do you think you're going to need in order for people to actually see?
10.
Probably at least 10. I mean, even if you had 5 and 5, that's not much on 2 shelves. At least that might be enough to grab someone's attention. So that means we're talking $10 million and that's for one chain. So how many chains are there in the United States?
Lots.
Yeah, lots. I mean, yes?
Well, there must be money in there, or else people would be doing it. So, I mean,
there must be money in paying, you mean in paying the
supply. Yeah, so Coca-Cola wouldn't be there.
Absolutely.
Wouldn't be making high margins if it was exorbitant. So I would say that if you think about the scale that you're pumping through those shelves, we're talking, you know, a couple hundred different grocery stores. That place is moving products.
And in fact,
it's a lot, but
Coke and Pepsi typically don't pay very much at all for typical shelf space. They'll pay for ends, you know, for end of aisle. Right, for certain really good locations, but think about the bargaining power that they have with the grocery store chain. The grocery store, all they have to say is, okay, don't sell Pepsi. Or, okay, don't sell Coke. Can you imagine customers coming in, you don't sell Coke? Like, are you kidding me? Are you really, you know, are you serious? You don't sell Coke? Like, what kind of a grocery store chain is this, right? This is where you get, you know, this is where you start to get the bargaining power. So they compete against each other for certain kind of locations in the store, but they're not going to pay the same amount. But one of the big challenges is, if you think about the grocery store business, it has been a very regional business, right? I mean, so those of you from, who's from California? And what are the big grocery store chains in California? Safeway?
Albertsons.
Which one?
Save Mart.
Albertsons, Vons,
Raley's,
Pavilions.
What's that?
Pavilions.
Yeah, Vons, Pavilions, Ralph's. Right. Those are. Okay. So, who here is from the East or the South? What are your grocery stores?
Publix.
Kroger and Tom Thumb.
Giant.
It's the Baltimore, Washington area. They're very big there.
Myers.
What area?
Ohio.
So I lived in Boston when I worked for Bain. I was in Boston for a few years, and when I was in the Philly area at Wharton, there were different grocery stores. In Boston, it was Stop and Shop or Star Market when you're in the market for the best. You know. So you know, a different set of chains in sort of the Northeast, at least the Boston area, in Philadelphia. So we had Supermarkets General, Pathmark. The one I sort of got a kick out of was Acme. Anybody seen an Acme grocery store? Yeah, so the Acme grocery store. So if you get the store brand, it says Acme. I felt like I was Wile E. Coyote. Anybody who's seen Wile E., you know, the Roadrunner, his were always Acme brand products. So, yes.
So for like a more upscale grocery store like Trader Joe's or a Sprouts, does it still work the same with shelf space, or is there more leniency? Because I've heard that sometimes they'll let you just come and put a product on their shelves, and if it sells,
So here's the way they think about it. So you pay money to get your product on the shelf. Then what they do, as any good tenant would do, they look at the rent that they generate from that space, which is a function of the margin that they generate per unit and the turnover. If you generate, so they're doing this calculation each year, they can tell you exactly how much they're making from each SKU in their store, you know, each area. They know how much they're making. If they're making a lot of money because there's a lot of turnover and a lot of margin for the store, then you're not going to have to continue to pay the slotting allowance because they're making good money because your product is selling. If it doesn't sell, then that's when you're going to have to pay the slotting allowance because we got to make it up somehow. You've got to pay to be on the shelf. So you usually have to pay the slotting allowance to get in the door or if you're not selling enough. So that's sort of the way it works. And the other thing is it's going to vary depending upon the size of the grocery store chain. So if it's one of the smaller chains, Acme is a smaller chain in the north, you know, in the Northeast, you're going to pay less there than if it's an Albertsons, a Kroger, you know, a Safeway, one that's it's going to be a bigger chain with a lot more stores, right? So that's why it's going to vary sort of chain to chain. Okay, question?
Do you have any idea what would be the cost for Walmart, for example, to get on the shelves at Walmart?
My understanding is that you take that, you know, you take that number of a million, and now with all of their outlets, Again, it depends on, you know, if you're trying to get space and you're willing to rent it without them saying, yeah, we think we can get a good return on that space, you're going to probably double that number. Yes?
Doesn't Walmart sort of take, they give their stores a little bit of flexibility with regional brands. They allow their managers to say, we want to try this in our stores. So if you had a strong local brand, that might be something you could work with.
Yes, that's possible. That's possible. So Walmart is an interesting case because they are actually one of the few companies to successfully enter this industry in the last few years, right? Anybody ever bought a Sam's Choice soft drink? I told you you could get Dr. Thunder there. So you can go and get a full line of drinks at Walmart that are sort of their store brand, that are, again, a lot less expensive. The great thing for them is they've got their own short shelf space. So it's not like they have to rent it, right? They just offer their own product, and they've been able to enter this particular industry, and they've been quite successful. So we're going to talk a little bit more about how do you enter this kind of an industry successfully. So I want to move to, so shelf space actually now, as you look at it, actually becomes a big deal. So you might need a different channel in order to be able to access customers. The question is, can you really get 10% share through, you know, through schools? It's probably going to be tough to get 10%, but at least it's a way to get in a niche market. All right, so any other, I'll open it up, any other reasons that you think Coke and Pepsi are really profitable that we haven't mentioned yet?
One of the things that we were talking about as a group is just the expectancy factor. You know, with Coke and Pepsi, you know what you're going to get. These new things that are coming about, it's just like, all right, you know, we can expect that they're kind of going to be like Coke, but am I going to like it as much as I like Coke? Since Pepsi and Coke have been around for, what, 80 years, something like that, then we're going to know what we get every single time we open up a Coke.
So there's something about sort of consistency, reliability around... Yeah, I know what I'm going to get, and therefore, I'm more comfortable just buying what I know what it's going to taste like. Why take a chance with a store brand if I'm not sure?
I think just something along with that, you only have to try like an off-brand once and taste how terrible it is to never want to really like venture out of your...
So it's possible that the off-brands... How many of you, though, let me ask this question. How many of you before today had tasted, know that you had tasted an off-brand cola before? Okay, so quite a few, and most of you that raised your hand, raise your hand again, and keep your hand raised if your experience was bad. So maybe half it was bad, half it wasn't. If you don't have a bad experience, so I know, actually I had one student in a class say, his mom would buy the store brand and then pour it into a Coke bottle. Put it in so they thought they were actually getting, you know, the real stuff. So that's one way to get around. If you're willing to take the time, then you can pull out, bring out the cola. Everybody's happy with the Coke because, you know, your mom got it for cheap and you get to, you know, serve your friends Coke. You know, the real thing. I thought that was pretty funny. Yes.
So, I mean, like, brand is a definite important reason why they've been able to keep margins so wide, but I don't think that fully explains it, because you have, there's also got to be something that has to do with their relationship with bottlers, and how they, once a bottler has decided to bottle for Coke, they are sort of locked into that. There's like, they can't change, they can't...
In fact, Coke and Pepsi own, right, a portion of those bottlers, which gives them some degree of control. If they're a partial owner of the bottlers, in many cases they used to be a majority owner. So, but for a lot of their bottlers, they're at least a minority owner. Okay, so keep going.
And so, if I'm a bottler, and I, even if we go back 20 years, you know, it's like they were just coffee to back into. So, when I'm a bottler and I've signed a contract with Coke, even if I want to change, I can't just sign a contract with Pepsi, because there's another bottler that's already a Pepsi bottler there. And so that gives Coke significant margin setting ability for the price of the concentrate. So that relationship is pretty set for them. That kind of helps them maintain their margin that otherwise.
Robert, how? So for your team, how did you get bottling? Did you end up building some of your own?
Yeah. What we did is we leveraged for the first 5% of market share, we leveraged existing bottling and just paid the fee of distribution. And then if we wanted to grow past that, we had to build our own.
And how much did building your own, how much did 5% of the market, how much did it cost you for bottling? What was your fixed cost investment in just plant and equipment?
$800. We assumed it was $110 million per plant, and each plant could do 40 cases.
Okay.
Or 40 million cases. Okay. So it was $880 million.
So for bottling, we think about a barrier to entry, the scale of operations. This was for concentrate. In fact, the bigger investment up front to get distribution of your product, if you're going to be big, because basically what you've learned is if you're going to be big, you can't do it. You're going to have your own bottling. So, and this actually tends to be true in many industries. The bigger you get, the more likely you are to vertically integrate, meaning the more likely you are to provide your own goods and services, do more of it internally, because you have the scale to do it. Early on, you want to outsource a lot. And we'll talk more about make versus buy later on. But for 5% share, you're looking at $880 million. That looks like a pretty big investment. In fact, in some ways, I would say that looks like a bigger investment than what you're making for concentrate.
Yeah, it's significantly more. I mean, it's only like 70 or 80 to have one concentrate participant supply on that.
So, Robert, this seems like a bigger barrier to entry into bottling than it is into concentrate. So can you explain to me why the bottling industry is less profitable than the concentrate industry?
So I would think that the, I still think part of it has to do with the relationship that they build. Like once you, as a bottler, I tool everything for Coke, and then after that point, I can't tool again for somebody to drink. It's expensive for me to do that. So I sort of kind of like locked into whatever the price per concentrate I'm getting.
So it's somehow that you're talking about this bargaining power.
Yeah,
issue.
It's like the inelasticity of the bottling market.
So concentrate has power over bottling, is sort of what you're saying.
Yeah.
And that allows concentrate to make more money than bottling.
Yeah, they can. Yeah, if bottling wants to make any money at all, they have to keep prices as close to the margin as possible.
Okay, so let me go to Scott. Scott, how would you explain this data? We know concentrate makes a lot more than bottling, right? It's like 20. Anybody know what the percentage is? Roughly 20 some odd percent. I think it's like 28%. 32%
32 to 9%.
8%. So 32, you can make 32% in concentrate, or you can make 8% in bottling. Okay, now you don't have to go to business school to know which is better, right? Most of us can count. It's pretty easy to see that it would be a much better idea to be in concentrate than it would be to be in bottling. So we would expect more firms to enter the concentrate industry if we believe economics. Some of you, I think, believe economics, right? If we believe in economics, we would expect that, in fact, we would expect more entry into the concentrate industry, right? Until what point should we see entry?
Economic profits are zero.
Okay, we should expect people to not go into bottling and instead go into concentrate so that these start to get closer, right? So that, in fact, at some point over time, bottling becomes more profitable because there's less entry. Because, heck, if I have a choice, I'm going to go into concentrate instead of bottling. Okay, for some reason, we don't see that. So we're trying to understand. Let's try and explain why we seem to have these persistently higher profits in concentrate than bottling. So Robert said they concentrate seems to have this bargaining power over bottling. Any other things you would point to as a...
So the bottling industry just faces much higher capital costs, so the other plants, it's a lot more money than the concentrate plants.
Okay, so bottling assets cost more. And this presents a barrier to entry, but it also may reduce your returns. Is that sort of what you're thinking? Because in theory, this investment should be a barrier to entry, but it also is a big investment, so maybe then you don't make this higher returns on your investment? Is that what?
Yeah, so I think, so they have to pay a lot of money for the plant, but then they also have to pay a lot more money for the actual materials to produce whatever it is that's bottled to drink. And then I think that goes together with, they have much higher transportation costs than a concentrate manufacturer, because the concentrate manufacturers create this syrup that you can make tons of Coke from, and they can transport it all relatively cheaply. But once you get everything in the bottles, everything's taking up a lot more space.
Okay. Anything else?
That's it.
Those are the main ones? Okay. I would like someone to walk through their answer to this question of why is concentrate more profitable than bottling. But I want you to use a framework to help you to provide the answer. And the framework I want you to use is the Five Forces model. So who is willing to take a shot at explaining to me why concentrate's more profitable than bottling and doing it in a systematic way using the Five Forces model framework? Okay?
So, starting out with competitive rivalry, splitting that between bottling and concentrate. In concentrate, we have two huge brands. Including the third one, Dr. Pepper Snapple Group. We have the market share of the concentrated soft drink industry about 90% owned by the top three players.
Okay. Three large players have basically 90% of the market.
And not only that, the size of that market is shrinking. So the room to enter it with the and what they're competing for is getting fiercer and fiercer. Analysts say it's shrinking 2% each year through 2016. Okay. So the fierceness of that competitive rivalry, the degree to which they're competing, is increasing year over year because the market's shrinking.
Let me ask you this question. So how many players are here?
There are hundreds of different players.
Okay.
However,
So do you think there's more rivalry here or more rivalry here?
I think there's more rivalry in concentrate for name brand, but bottling, it said in the case that Coke owns somewhere between 50 and 75% of their bottling operations.
Okay.
So that competitive rivalry floods over to the bottling industry because how much of it is owned by the big players in the concentrate business.
Okay.
Going to barriers of entry, we have the cost of operations that were already said, as well as what we were talking about earlier.
Is the cost higher here or here?
It's higher in bottling.
Okay. So we have, it's higher for the bottling plants, right?
Right.
Upfront cost in the plants, right?
So we're looking between 6 and 10 million to serve 40 million cases, as opposed to 50 million to serve 10% of the whole carbonated soft drink industry.
Okay. So they're more expensive, and we've got the concentrate plant is less expensive. But so far, if you're saying that the barriers to entry are higher here, and the rivalry's higher here, or the rivalry's higher here, and the barriers to entry are lower, then we would expect concentrate to be less profitable.
Right. The biggest problems come with buyer and supplier power.
Okay. Let's go to buyer power.
Right. Okay.
This is grocery store chains and consumer.
So the bottling company, or the bottling sub-industry of the carbonated soft drink industry, their buyers are retail and other shelf space, vending machines, etc. One of the problems that they have, though, is before they were owned by the concentrate manufacturers, and in current contracts that they have with concentrate manufacturers, how they market, the prices that they sell, and pretty much what they do as a supplier of Coke to retailers or Pepsi retailers is controlled by the concentrate firms.
Okay, so these guys have lots of firepower. Lots of power over.
They have lots
machines.
Of supplier power over the bottling companies.
Right.
Right.
So let's put this, let's just make sure we're clear here what we're talking about. Who are the suppliers, if we think about, who are the suppliers of inputs to the bottling?
The concentrate and then commodities to build the bottles.
Right. So we've got, this is commodities, and do they have any bargaining power?
No.
No. But the concentrate is a big deal, right?
Right.
If you're not putting Coke or Pepsi or one of their products in that bottle, you're not putting something that's likely to sell in that bottle, right? So when we think about it, their suppliers of the concentrate actually have lots and lots of power over
right.
it. Right? And that comes from the brand.
Right.
All right, and then we think about buyer power, power over the buyers.
That comes from the concentrate over their buyers being the bottlers.
And who are the buyers of the bottlers?
Retailers, vending machine distributors, other shelf space.
Okay. So actually, if we think about these, you've got retailers and end users are in some ways the buyers for the output of both, because they're bottling the concentrate
right,
company's products. Mm-hmm. The fact of the matter is, though, bottlers without the concentrate product have no bargaining power
correct.
Over these folks, whereas the concentrate folks have lots of power over the retailers or the end user because of their brand. All right, now one thing that's important here, so we've got concentrate plants are less, but we missed a couple of other important barriers to entry. Brand. Brand, you're spending $200 million a year. You could build that bottle, you know, a whole bottling system for $1 billion or $1.5 billion, let's say. And that's actually a lot less than what Coke is, you know, spends in 5 or 6 years just on advertising. So in fact, brand becomes a big barrier to entry to this shelf space. We mentioned that earlier. Getting shelf space is a barrier to entry. How easy is it to get into fountains or restaurants?
Difficult.
Why?
Because the biggest fountain drink, like fast food chains, McDonald's, or National Movie Theaters, or whatever, you get fountain space, or whatever you call it, through the national chain.
But the issue is, they typically have long-term contracts. You can't just go in, or they also want to carry a brand.
Right.
So brand makes a difference, but they have long-term contracts. And then, of course, the other is, how easy is it to get into vending machines? You'd have to build your own vending machine network, right? So if you think about the whole distribution side, huge barriers to entry. You can't get in to fountains. You can't get shelf space very easily. You'd have to build your own vending machine network. So getting the distribution is very costly. Building the brand is very costly. Concentrate plant itself is actually a fairly minor part in terms of a barrier to entry into this particular business. All right, so if concentrate is so much more profitable than bottling, why are Coke and Pepsi in bottling?
Because it eliminates the buyer power that their buyers used to be able to or could possibly exercise over them. It changes that strategic competitive landscape so that it's in their favor and makes it so any potential new entrant has a huge barrier to entry because they own, because suppliers are commodities, no one getting into CSD industry has to worry about commodities. Commodities, price stays the same.
So think about, for all of you, as you thought about this market entry, wouldn't it have been a lot easier if you hadn't had to build bottling, right? If Coke and Pepsi control the bottling, it actually increases the barrier to entry into concentrate. They're in bottling to protect the golden goose, which is the concentrate side, right? So it's not that they're making, because this is a non-differentiated sort of business, right? It's not like you can do much to really differentiate what you do in bottling. So there's no real good reason for Coke and Pepsi to be in it. And so that's part of the reason that they were in it for a while to control it, and then they pulled back. Just, all they want is control. Mm-hmm. They don't actually necessarily want to be a major player, but they want to control it to prevent access for new entrants into the bottling industry.
Yes? Did anyone, like, in their minds, like, forego the whole bottling thing?
You can't, because the bottlers would only give you up to 5%, and then after 5% market share, you have to have your own.
Yeah, unless you chose like a school strategy, or you could try a strategy where you don't have to bottle.
We chose a strategy where we didn't have to bottle.
Sort of like the SodaStream idea, where you know you actually have somebody, they actually could make their own soda, right? That's the only way, other way I know to get around bottling.
Yeah.
Because you gotta have a product like that.
So we went just like basically found drink machines that would, you could create your own flavors.
Create your own flavors.
The electronics yeah. that they put. And we just had a different distribution channel through like a red box setup.
And that's a completely different way to enter this particular market. Now, there's a reading, it's for those of you who've had Manic 387, you may have had it, but it's Strategies for Cracking Well-Guarded Markets. It's a paper by Professor Bryce and myself. And that's one of the reasons that I would recommend for the next time when we sort of talk about this. But it looks at how do you actually crack a market that has high barriers to entry? And do you even want to try is really part of the issue. All right, so let me just summarize a couple of key ideas here, and then we'll talk about it more. We'll be meeting from Friday the 24th, and we'll be, instead of 2:30 at noon, we'll be in 2:20, just one over at noon.
If we have another class during that time, how can we get the material?
I'll make sure all of the material's available.
Okay.
Well, we'll put it online, and I'll probably have a video of it as well, if you want to.
Okay, perfect.
All right, so this particular case provides this understanding of the underlying economics of an industry and its relationship to average industry profits. It's sort of like, why do some industries make more than others? That's part of the reason I like to use this case. It's because we can compare concentrate and bottling, but we also can tell from this little taste test we did that the product itself is not that differentiated. At least in terms of the actual taste, it's differentiated completely on brand and intangibles. The barriers to entry are what are key. And so let me tell you this. When you see an industry where it has high profits relative to other industries and they are persistent, think barriers to entry. There must be barriers to entry. Otherwise, those firms would enter. Other firms would enter that industry and bid down those profits. We still might see some of it, but there have to be barriers to entry. In my view, that is the most important of the five forces. We'll go through the five forces model. But hey, if I get bargaining power in an industry and make a lot of money over suppliers or buyers, I'll enter, unless there's a barrier to entry. So the barriers to entry are really the key to sustaining high profits in an industry. In this particular case, the key barriers to entry are brand equity, as we identified, the bottling and franchise system, which turns out to be, you know, very expensive. You've got to be, you know, either a very niche player or you got to be big. And then the limited shelf space and sort of fountains and vending machines, it's very tough to get distribution because of the barriers to entry, the cost that's associated with entering this particular industry. So relative to bottling, the concentrate industry has fewer substitutes. You know, bottlers have aluminum, steel, plastic, glass in terms of the different ways you could bottle a soft drink. They have greater bargaining power with suppliers. Raw materials for concentrate are largely commodities like sugar, and buyers, both grocery store, convenience store buyers, and end users are very, very fragmented. So from this notion that there are three players that control 90% of the market, as soon as you see that, you should think they have bargaining power, right? Because this is an oligopoly taking advantage of a fragmented customer base. Okay, an oligopoly meaning very few players taking advantage of lots of customers. That means they're likely to have bargaining power. This all adds up to a more attractive industry structure for concentrate. And it raises the question about, can you successfully enter this industry today? The article on strategies to crack well-guarded markets addresses that particular question. So we'll talk about that next time. What's that?
Yeah, article is not available.
So you should be able to get, I have copies in my office. If you want to stop up, I'll be happy to give you one. But all of the Harvard Business Review articles are available through the Harold B. Lee Library. It's Business Source Premier, the database, and we have a site license for these articles that you should be able to access through Business Source Premier. Yes?
Oh, I was just going to ask, is today's assignment going to be due next Friday, or will it be due the following Monday?
So, today, you mean the
assignment we get to do from today's class?
So from today's class, it will be due a week from Monday.
Okay.
So you don't have to turn it in on Friday, it'll be due a week from Monday. Okay, last point I want to make is that if you think about why, again, we think about logic trees, we think about structured problem solving, what is driving superior profitability of a company? The answer tends to be, it's either I'm in an industry where we're all making good money, or I have a great position in that industry because of my strategy and my ability to offer unique value. What we're going to focus on, you know, next time in the next couple of class periods is, you know, what are the characteristics of attractive industries, and there are things we can do to shape that so that we can make more money along with our competitors. Okay. All right, so we'll see you a week from Friday.